Good morning and welcome to the 14th meeting of the Rural Affairs and Islands Committee in 2024. Before we begin, can I remind those using electronic devices to please switch them to silent. This morning we've received apologies from Rachel Hamilton and Ariane Burgess, and I welcome Jamie Halkett-Johnston and Matt Ruskell to the who will be attending the meeting as substitutes. As this is Mark's first time joining us as a committee substitute, I would like to invite him to declare any relevant interests. Mark.
Thank you very much, Convener. I should obviously declare that I have a Members Bill proposal entitled the Prohibition of Greyhound Racing Scotland Bill, which I'm currently working on. I'm also an honorary associate member of the British Veterinary Association, and I'm also a beekeeper, which is probably of less relevance to today's session, but you never know. It may come up.
No, I'm not doing my job if it does. Thank you, Mark. Our first item of business is to decide whether to take item three today in private. Are we all agreed?
Yeah.
Can we also agree to consider our annual report and take an update on petition PE1490, control of wild goose numbers, in private our next meeting? This means that next week's meeting will be entirely in private. Our next item of business is consideration of petition PE1758, which calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to end greyhound racing in Scotland. And welcome to the meeting, Jim Fairley, the Minister for Agriculture and Connectivity, and Andrew Voss, the Veterinary Head of Animal Welfare from the Scottish Government. And as usual, I'll kick off with a question, and can I ask you, Minister, how do you believe that existing animal welfare legislation and enforcement protects racing greyhounds in Scotland at the different stages of their life, from birth through racing and retirement?
If you don't mind, Convener, I'll make an opening statement to the position that we're in at the moment. Is that
certainly?
Are you happy with that? Okay. I'm very happy to appear before the committee today to discuss the petition PE1758, which calls for an end to greyhound racing in Scotland. Animal welfare is an important issue for the vast majority of people in Scotland, and it's also an issue that the Scottish Government takes very seriously, and we are committed to the highest standards when it comes to the welfare of all animals in Scotland. The Scottish Government recognise there is support for action to address the welfare concerns associated with greyhound racing, and this is why we agreed to include greyhound racing in the animal licensing consultation we ran last year, and when we sought views on the regulation of greyhound tracks in Scotland. Our consultation confirmed that action on greyhound racing is strongly supported, with approximately half of respondents supporting licensing and half responding that they were not sure about it. Those that were not sure about licensing were of the opinion that it did not go far enough and that only a ban would be effective in protecting greyhound welfare. Over and above the consultation responses received, over 1,100 campaign responses were also sent to the Scottish Government Animal Welfare Team, with the campaign signatories calling for an end to greyhound racing entirely. This morning, I'm sure we will discuss the evidence for and against prohibition of greyhound racing in Scotland, and I welcome the opportunity to engage in those discussions. I advise the committee, however, that at this time the Scottish Government is not persuaded of the need to ban greyhound racing in Scotland. In particular, we are not convinced that a ban on greyhound racing in Scotland is proportionate and a fair response to the animal welfare concerns arising from the practice. As the members of this committee know, in Scotland we now have only one active greyhound track, that's Thornton Stadium in Fife. And Thornton runs as an independent track in that it does not operate under the rules of the Greyhound Board of Great Britain. Attendance at Thornton, both by those racing dogs and those spectating, has been declining for many years as interest in the sport wanes and the public opinion against greyhound racing shifts. While on-site gambling is still a traditional part of the race nights at Thornton, it takes place on a considerably lesser scale than occurs at Greyhound Board of Great Britain venues, where races are often televised, competition is intense, and gambling happens on a commercial scale. And the central argument for prohibiting greyhound racing in Scotland is the published Greyhound Board of Great Britain statistics on greyhound deaths and injuries attributed to racing. The Scottish Government agrees that the statistics presented are unacceptable and that any greyhound injury and death is something that must be addressed. However, it must be recognised that currently we do not have verifiable comparable data for Thornton Stadium, and so the statistics for greyhound injuries and death relate to those incurred as part of the much larger scale greyhound racing which takes place in England. So we must therefore caution against making assumptions about the current situation in Scotland and legislating to ban a sport, however contentious, without sound evidence base for doing so. And one last point, Convener, is that as far as the Scottish Government is aware, there have been no complaints made to the Scottish SPCA about the activities at Thornton Stadium and no enforcement action taken due to animal welfare concerns against the operators of the venue. Again, I would stress that these factors must be borne in mind when considering the case for the proportionality of a ban in Scotland. I'll end there, and I'm happy to take part in the conversation as we go forward.
Thank you. So to just go back to my original question, how do you believe that the existing animal welfare legislation protects racing greyhounds in Scotland from birth right through to retirement?
Well, the 2006 Act has it in its very core that the animal welfare conditions must be met for all animals, and that includes greyhounds in Scotland. And as I've just made in the opening statement, the understanding of what happens at Thornton is an entirely different beast from what is happening at the very professional, highly charged atmospheres of the tracks down south that are about betting and gambling and dogs as commodities, rather than what we think we understand about Thornton, where you're looking at dogs that are as much part of the family and family pets as they are for racing. So the welfare conditions of those dogs, I think, is an entirely different thing from what it is that we're talking about with the professional tracks down south.
I'm going to refer to the 2006 Act that you've touched on. And consideration has got to be made with regards to whether the suffering was proportionate to the purpose of the conduct concerned. What level of suffering do you think is proportionate when it comes to greyhound racing?
The level of suffering proportion... OK.
Stated that you think the 2006 Act...
Yeah.
Is adequate to protect greyhounds, but in the Act it suggests that consideration to which regard has to be had includes whether the suffering was proportionate to the purpose of the conduct concerned.
Okay,
so what I'm asking is, when it comes to greyhound racing, what level of suffering do you think is proportionate to greyhound racing?
I'm going to let Andrew answer that question.
Okay, yeah, I mean, you're referring to the offence of causing or permitting unnecessary suffering in the 2006 Act. And as you say, and I think Mike Radford explained this in the evidence in the SORC session, that for that offence to be committed, you have to demonstrate there was suffering and that the suffering was unnecessary. And as you say, regard can be had to whether that was as part of a legitimate activity. So I think the point that Mike was making was that greyhound racing, if it's regarded as a legitimate activity, it can involve, we all know there are injuries associated with greyhound racing, but if that's part of the legitimate activity of racing, then that wouldn't necessarily be regarded as an offence of unnecessary suffering. But if you're doing something that was unusual or was unreasonable in those circumstances, then an offence may have been committed.
Okay. I suppose it's really a political decision on the level of suffering, and it's something that so the minister's satisfied that the current legislation actually covers those situations. You touched on concerns around Thornton, which are probably not really relevant here. We're not talking about specific tracks; we're talking about greyhound racing in general. But I'm going to bring in Emma Roddick for a supplementary.
Thank you, Convener. I appreciate the points the Minister's made around Thornton and the difference in terms of treatment as to the concerns that are being posed about different tracks in England. I wonder if he can speak to the fact that greyhounds here are often raced in England, and also whether he believes that current regulation is strong enough to prevent, say, a different kind of track being set up in Scotland as well.
Well, we talked about that when I was a member of this committee. We talked about the potential for straight tracks and all the rest. There is, as far as I'm aware, there is no desire to run straight tracks. And I think in one of the evidence sessions, I actually stated that running a racetrack wouldn't limit the potential risk for injury. We talked about working with double lures. I asked that question myself at one point, in order to look at different ways of mitigating risk. I think the point that we have to make is that you cannot mitigate risk completely, and it's about mitigating risk for potential injuries. The convener has worked on farms. I've had working sheepdogs my entire life. There is inherent risk in every activity they take part in, whether it is agility training, whether it's flyball, whether it's terrier racing, whether it's pigeon racing. There is inherent risk in potentially working with animals at any stage. So I'm not sure where you get the figures from to state that there are lots of dogs that are being raced in England. I don't get that. I don't know where that figure comes from. Perhaps you'll be able to tell me about that. But
I think, Minister, we heard right through the evidence that there was dogs, and we heard from breeders that there was dogs bred in Scotland, which then travelled to race in GBGB tracks across the rest of the UK. So it does; it's a fact.
But why would banning them racing in England, banning them in Scotland, stop them racing in England? I don't understand the point of that. That's what I'm trying to get to.
That's what I'm asking. If there are welfare risks to dogs that are living in Scotland, perhaps even bred in Scotland, how do we prevent that kind of welfare risk being put to them, if you know the minister is saying that actually there are tracks in England where the welfare risk would be considerable in a way that the Thornton is not to him?
Well, we'd have to stop them from going across the border to race in order to mitigate that risk, and I don't see how we can do that.
And just for clarification, so my original question was about how we protect dogs that are racing at different stages of their life from birth through racing and retirement. I think Emma's supplementary was, how do we protect those dogs that go and race south of the border in GBGB tracks?
Well, under the same terms of the 2006 Act, they would have the owners would have the same requirement to look after those dogs, whether they're racing in England or they're racing in Scotland.
Okay, does that answer your question, Emma?
I think so, thank you.
Thank you. Elena Whittam.
Good morning, Minister. The Scottish Animal Welfare Commission concluded that a dog bred for racing in Scotland currently has poorer welfare than the average of the dogs in the population. And I just want to focus on that for a little while because we were... Can you not hear me? Do you want me to start again? Oh, there's an echo.
Yeah, that's it. Go ahead.
Thank you. I'll start again. Good morning, Minister. The Scottish Animal Welfare Commission concluded that a dog bred for racing in Scotland currently has poorer welfare than the average of other dogs in the population. And, you know, they're referring to how they're bred, how they're reared, trained and raced, indeed how they're retired if they get to that point, or indeed perhaps how they may end their life by being put down. And also they talk about the issue of wastage within the industry. And I'm wondering, does the Scottish Government agree with this overall conclusion that dogs that are bred for greyhound racing have a poor standard of welfare throughout their lives?
We talked about this during our session as well, but those are dogs largely were bred in Ireland. I think that's what the SOC report was talking about, and that were brought over to Scotland. But I go back to the point I made right at the start. What is currently happening in Scotland, the vast majority of the people that are racing dogs in Scotland that we understand are doing it as part of their family pets. They'll have two or three dogs, maybe four or five dogs, but they're part of the family. And the intensity and the high-stakes gambling that happens in the tracks down south is not the same as what's happening here in Scotland. So therefore, it would be disproportionate to ban what is a pastime for the vast majority of people who do it here in Scotland, as opposed to the professionalism of what is happening down south. And I'm trying to keep those two things entirely separate, because I'm making a distinction between the two things.
Okay, I can understand the distinction that needs to be made, but following on from my colleague Emma Roddick's points, if we are taking evidence in this place from breeders that do have 40 dogs in kennels in Scotland who are then racing them down in tracks in England, the welfare of those dogs is of paramount concern to those in this committee and indeed the petitioners. But I guess it does come back to the 2006 Act and about the balancing out of what is the acceptable level of harm that may come to those dogs or their welfare concerns. So I don't know if you've got any points to come back on with that.
Yeah, the report that you're talking about, the regulation of welfare of racing greyhounds. It's stated in there, greyhounds are also subject to a number of other pieces of legislation, including the Welfare of Animals Transport Scotland Regulations 2006, Microchipping of Dogs Scotland Regulations 2016, Animal Welfare Licensing Activities Involving Animals Regulations 2021. And none of these pieces of legislation specifically covers the welfare of greyhounds, but all greyhounds are covered by that legislation. So they've got those protections in place. There's a number of other additional initiatives that are focused on the attempts to ensure the welfare of greyhounds in racing. A coalition of animal welfare organisations, industry representatives have established over many years. There's an advisory board on regulation of greyhounds. But I continue to come back to the point that I think we have a different situation in Scotland for the people who are keeping and racing greyhounds in Scotland as to what happens in England.
If I may just come back on one wee point. With regards to the assertion about them being pets, I think this is where we get a bit confused with how the tracks operate in two different places, because we do have the issue with GBGB tracks. The animals must be kept in kennels. They cannot be part of a family setup. And I'm not so sure if that actually works for dogs that are raced in, at the only track that we have currently in Scotland. I don't know whether they are able to be part of the family or whether indeed they have to be kennelled and not part of the family as a pet to race. And I think this is where it gets a bit confusing for us to try and unpick the differences between here and England.
OK, again, I'm going to keep referring back to that when I was on this committee. When this was first raised, I have a friend who has rescued greyhounds over a number of years. So I contacted him and asked him, what is the reality here in Scotland? And he sent me this response. If you don't mind, convener, I'll read this out. This is his words, not mine. He says, my greyhounds were all rescues, failed racers. However, I did race them with great success, and I add, all were kept till they died, till the day they died, and buried here on the place that he lived. Jim, the dogs love racing. It's just the same as dogs doing agility or fly ball. As usual, the fault is with owners, and perversely, although the flapping owners get the worst press, they are actually not the main problem. Many of them keep the retired dogs on as pets, as they have a bond with their dog. The main problem is the professionals. These are the dogs discarded as if they are of no use. Owners only turn up on race night. They just want to own a winner. And that kind of touches the point that Eleanor Whittam is making. They will not pay a trainer to keep what they describe as a pot licker, and trainers have a reputation to build, and that can only be done with winners. These are the people who want to get rid of poor quality dogs. A big problem is with far too many dogs being bred in Ireland. Poor conditions, backstreet vets and bitches who are just money-making machines. That, mind you, goes on in this country in puppy farms of all breeds, not just greyhounds. And that was his response to my questioning after we'd had this session in here.
With all due respect, can I remind you, you're here speaking on behalf of the Scottish Government. You're the Minister.
So as the Minister,
the Government's position we want in this. And the question that we had was quite clear. This is based on the Scottish Animal Welfare Commission report, which concluded, and I quote, a dog bred for racing in Scotland currently has poorer welfare than the average of other dogs in the population. Do you, as the Minister, agree with that overall conclusion?
If a dog bred in Scotland has poorer outcomes?
A dog bred for racing in Scotland.
Has poorer outcomes than other
has
dogs.
Has poorer welfare than average of other dogs.
I can't give an answer to that question. Because I genuinely can't remember having that part of the conversation.
But you're the minister.
Yep.
And the Scottish Animal Welfare Commission report is one of the fundamental pieces of evidence relating to this petition. And you're saying that you can't tell us whether you agree with the overall conclusions or not. And it's very straightforward. Dogs bred for racing in Scotland currently have poorer welfare than the average of other dogs.
OK, if that is their conclusion, then that is the conclusion they have taken. But it doesn't change the position that I have right now.
Agree or disagree with that position?
Well, it's their position, so I will accept the fact that that is SOC's position.
OK. Emma Roddick.
Thank you, Convener. The committee heard that most racing greyhounds kennelled in Scotland were bred in Ireland, but the SOC report said that there was a lack of data on dogs in early life. So does the Scottish Government hold information that the Minister can share, or is there information accessible from public agencies or databases, for example, about greyhounds coming to Scotland from Ireland or other countries? Can the Minister speak to whether breeding in Scotland is an issue in addition to the Ireland issue that we've been discussing?
I don't think we have those numbers, but Andrew will maybe have a better idea.
No, we don't hold any information other than that was explained in the SOC report and in the SOC evidence session, so we haven't any further information than that.
OK, and if I can come back as well on other concerns around dogs being bred for specific purposes and the welfare issues that they then experience, drawing on what the Minister had said about other breeds being of concern in Scotland at this time. Does he believe that current regulations, the animal welfare regulations, adequately cover those dogs and that they are being protected?
Yes, I do.
Okay. Thank you. Beatrice Wishart.
And good morning. Do you think there's need for more traceability of greyhounds in early life in Scotland and across the UK? And if so, how do you think that could be achieved?
Yeah, I do. And it's not just greyhounds, it's all dogs. That's why we are looking at the microchipping of all dogs. It's part of the... What is that report that we're doing on the microchipping?
Yeah, there was a recent UK consultation on improving microchipping. And we're currently engaged in a working group with officials in Dyffryn Wales looking at improving the operation of the current microchip system across GB. So looking in particular at improving the traceability in terms of having the breeder's records permanently associated with the dog's microchip and having a single point of access to the microchip databases.
So there'll be one system across the UK, one compatible system, if you like.
Well, that's what we're working towards. There would still be multiple databases, but there'll be a single point of access into those multiple databases. That's the proposal that we're working on at the moment.
Okay, thank you.
Just to follow up on that, you know, we've heard throughout the evidence that the Republic of Ireland is one of the major issues here, potentially, with lack of data, but also... you know, traceability. Should it, or does the Republic of Ireland need to be part of that micro-based chip identification to allow it to work? And is that achievable?
Well, we can only legislate in the in Scotland or the UK. There are EU proposals to look at requiring compulsory microchipping of dogs and cats across Europe. So in the longer term, we may be looking at a European system, and potentially we could align with that European system, but that's it, obviously in the longer term.
Okay, what are the timescales for the UK side of it, the GB side of it, and then what's your views on what the timescales might be for the European revision?
Yeah, the UK government, that's ongoing at the moment, that's being pressed right now. We don't have any timescale as yet, we haven't had any agreement from the UK, but it's definitely something that is being worked on.
Okay, thank you. Emma Harper.
I think, Convener, for the moment, that was covered. I was going to bring up the issue of the Republic of Ireland and the traceability that they have put in place, because greyhound racing is really, it's it's quite central to, you know, and important for people in the Republic of Ireland. So I would be interested in just following up on down the line when it comes to like one microchip database for the whole of the UK, because I'm interested in that part of it. So
we will certainly keep the committee informed as and when there is any developments in that, if that would be helpful.
Mr. Allen.
Thank you, Convener. The SAWC report also spoke a bit about, its words were, that independent tracks might have some social benefit. I'm not sure whether this was intended to mean social benefit for the dogs or the humans, but I just wonder if you could say anything about whether you view the independent tracks that remain, or track singular that remains, as having a social benefit, how you would understand that, what you make of that bit of the report.
Well, obviously, this kind of goes back to the point that the convener was making. I'm absolutely here representing the Scottish Government's position, but I am also looking at it from the point of view of where I have been involved in animal, working with animals. So, and I'm trying to juggle the two things at the same time. There is absolutely a social element to all of these things, whether it's sheepdog trials, racing pigeons, and my understanding is for greyhound racing as well. That there's a social element to it, it is part of the community. People go there, they meet up with their pals, they have an evening out, they bet on their own dogs, and it is a social gathering that they're taking part in.
So, I mean, I suppose my question really is how do we balance that with animal welfare, and which, no pun intended, is top dog?
I think the two have to go hand in hand. You can't compromise the animal welfare side of it. You have to make sure that the animal welfare side is being treated very seriously. And I think that in this particular circumstance that we're talking about, that animal welfare is very, very important.
OK, thank you, Commissioner.
Jimmy Halker-Johnson.
Thanks very much. Just following up from that point, I mean, you've talked about the kind of nature of these tracks. These are dogs that are part of the family. They're obviously unregulated, not part of GBGB's regulations. Are you aware that gambling does happen, or betting does happen at these tracks?
In the track in Thornton, the last one that's open in Scotland, yes, gambling does happen. In fact, if the gambling doesn't happen, then the race doesn't go ahead. So there is definitely a correlation between the two. But it's not the high stakes, you know, televised gambling, which is, you could be described as more of a professional thing rather than what they're doing in the Thornton track. It's a wee bit like pigeon racing. Guys will put money on their pigeons. They pool them every week. They'll put money on each bird. If that bird comes in, it's not about making money. It's about adding to the excitement of the social occasion that Alistair Allen has been alluding to.
I'll take your word on that. I'm not a great put some of knowledge on pigeon racing, I have to admit. But I mean, I take it that gambling is regulated, gambling, yes. Or it's not just happening on the track there.
Yes, I've accompanied the SAWC visit to Thornton in November 22, so I've spoke to some of the participants there, and I spoke to the bookmaker as well. So the situation is there is a bookmaker who obviously has to be licensed to be in business as a bookmaker, but there's only on-site betting is allowed. It is on a very small scale, so it is completely different from the televised sort of off-site gambling that goes on with the GBGB tracks.
And I suppose I would ask what the Scottish Government's position is, that they're comfortable that licensing regulation, that's not providing a loophole or anything like that with an independent, unregulated track.
I'm not sure what you mean. The bookkeeper has to be licensed.
No, I mean more generally. I mean, I suppose the GBGB sites are all regulated, although it's self-regulation. I mean, do you have confidence in their self-regulation, albeit that there are no tracks in Scotland? Does the Scottish Government have a position on that?
On the gambling side of it?
I'm just talking about the general regulations of the GBGB sites.
We don't have... I'm sorry, I'm not understanding the thrust of your question.
I recognise that there are no GBGB sites, okay, racetracks in Scotland, but they are. But the sites across the UK are regulated by GBGB, yeah?
Just not in Scotland.
But that's right. But as Emma pointed out, there are dogs that are racing on those sites going from Scotland, but also in the more general approach to this petition and the Scottish Government's position on greyhound racing, do you have confidence in the regulations or the self-regulations of GB?
I can't answer that because I haven't looked at the regulation of GBGB tracks because they don't exist here in Scotland.
Okay. If I can then move slightly, I mean, if it's the Scottish Government's position then, because you pointed out earlier that you don't believe there's a need for a ban on the sites in Scotland. If there was, which sounds unlikely given the kind of moves against or the change in atmosphere in terms of greyhound racing, if there was a move to establish a site, a GBGB site in Scotland, would you oppose it?
We would have to look at that proposition if that came to the government.
Okay. So we could have a situation that you're comfortable with unregulated sites, but you may oppose a site that's regulated, albeit self-regulated by GBGB.
We would look at that proposition as it came forward. We'd have to look at them independently.
Okay. All right. Thanks.
Mark Roscoe.
Thanks. You made quite a distinction here today, Minister, about regulated tracks versus unregulated tracks. So we do have a regulated track in Scotland. It's at Shawfield. It hasn't been open for a number of years. And then obviously we've got the unregulated track in Thornton. What's the difference in terms of track design and the inherent risk to dogs that are racing at Thornton and racing at Shawfield? Is there a difference between those tracks?
The track at Shawfield is closed. It hasn't been opened post-COVID, so I'm not sure that one was actually looked at as a racing track. But my understanding is
it has operated as a racing track. We've got
it has operated as a racing track in the past. I understand,
and it's still
that.
There. Yeah.
But what you asked specifically about the design, the design of the track is no different, as far as I'm aware. I could be wrong on that, and Andrew can correct me if I'm wrong. But my understanding is that it's an oval track, in exactly the same way as it is at Thornton, so there is no difference.
So are dogs race differently at Thornton compared to Shawfield? Are they raced at different speeds? What's the difference in terms of the inherent risk if the tracks are the same?
I can't answer to Shawfield because it's not a track that's currently open in Scotland.
Right, but it is a track that's in existence, and we have figures for injuries and deaths when there was racing there. And they're slightly higher, I think, than the average across Great Britain. So what is the difference in the inherent risk? If you're a dog and you're racing at Thornton, what's the difference? What's the difference in terms of the risk of leg breaks or other injuries that could be life-threatening? What's the difference between racing at Thornton compared to racing at a GBGB track elsewhere in the UK or at Shawfield?
My understanding of the difference in risk is the intensity and the professionalism and the requirement for what people are getting out of it. As I stated earlier on, there is a high demand for winners. People want to own winners at these GBGB tracks. They are highly competitive. There's a lot of money involved. And it is a sport which is driven by the financial aspects of it and the prestige of it, rather than what I understand Thornton to be, where they are largely family-owned pets, and the requirement or the determination to win isn't as great or as the fundamental thing for why they keep them.
I mean, I think you said earlier that you believe through the evidence that you've had is there's a kind of lesser scale gambling at Thornton.
Yep.
What difference does that make to a dog? So if a dog is racing...
It wouldn't make any difference at all.
If a dog is racing at Thornton or a dog is racing at Shawfield, what does that kind of lesser scale gambling environment actually mean in terms of animal welfare, and where's the evidence that you have?
It won't make any difference to the dog whatsoever. What will make a difference to it is the owner's attitude to the dog.
Right, where's your evidence for that in terms of stats and figures and...
That's anecdotal, right. Through speaking to the people who I've actually spoken to, some of the evidence that we've taken from here, in terms of the professionalism that goes on at a GBGB track, that is about them having professional high-stakes dogs running for the purpose of getting a winner, as opposed to somebody who's racing a dog that is... That's not the fundamental reason for having the dog.
OK. So GBGB does have standards, and they do, for example, have a requirement for a vet at track side. Yep. Are you saying that it's more preferable to actually have an unlicensed sort of environment, same tracks, same risk to the dogs, but that's actually better than a kind of licensed GBGB setup in terms of animal welfare?
Well, the Scottish Government are still considering the option of licensing for the unregulated track that we have here in Scotland. That's still a consideration that we will come back to. But this proposition is about banning greyhound racing in Scotland altogether. So we haven't talked about or worked on the issues of licensing, but it's something that we would consider for the Thornton track. But it should be pointed out there has been no response and no reports to the SSPCA at any time for any actions that have happened at the Thornton track. I think during one of the evidence sessions, the owner of the track, I think his name was Paul Brignall, I could be wrong on that, I think that's his name, he said here in session that he was more than happy for the SSPCA to come and visit them at any time. Now, I've tried to actually go to the... my intention, when I knew that I was taking this bill forward, was to go to the track, but it's been closed because there has been such a shortage of dogs, or they couldn't get a bookie, or for whatever the reason is. So it seems clear to me that the sport is on the wane in Scotland anyway. So we will consider all of those things when we come to the point of looking at what a licence may or may not do.
I'm just wondering where you get your evidence from as a minister, and also, you know, as a got an official there who's a, you know, long qualified vet and has led a number of, you know, animal welfare pieces of legislation through the Parliament. I mean, the information that you've received about Thornton is from a friend, I think you said. I've got evidence, anecdotal, actually quite strong evidence, that there's dogs that race at Thornton that are housed in a shed down at Seafield. So we could pop out at lunchtime and have a look at that. That could be good evidence if you want. So I'm just interested in how do we break through the kind of anecdotal nature of this evidence and actually get clear evidence about the nature of the risks of both licensed and unlicensed tracks, and therefore the case for reform, whether that's licensing, which it appears that you're undecided about whether licensing has a role or not, or a phase-out, which is obviously being proposed in my member's bill. So are you open to evidence, or is it fixed now? Yeah, you've had the letter, that's it.
No, you've hit the nail on the head there. I am still open to evidence. I'm still open to having these conversations. We'll watch your member's bill as it comes through very closely. And as I said, the consideration about licensing is still ongoing. So we're not saying that we've dismissed this and it's not something that we're going to think about anymore. It is just that at this stage, we don't think that a ban is proportionate in terms of what it is that we're looking at for the track that we're talking about.
Oh, thanks, Convener. I'll maybe come back later, but thank you.
Thank you. Just before we move on, can I just get your views on this? So in independent tracks, are you suggesting that the social benefits outweigh any animal welfare concerns?
What I'm saying is that in the independent track, that the two things should go hand in hand. It's not a case of one being more important than the other, but I think the two balanced together give good opportunity for socialising and social interaction, which is important, but that shouldn't be at the cost of welfare standards for the dogs that are running there.
And you think that balance is right at the moment?
Well, yes, I do.
OK, that's fine. Thank you. Beatrice Wishart.
But I'm happy to be proven wrong if evidence can come forward to do so.
The Scottish Animal Welfare Commission report raised specific risks for welfare at independent tracks through the lack of immediate veterinary care, and recommended a vet should be required at tracks to collect injury and fatality data. Given that recommendation, is the Scottish Government currently minded to introduce a requirement for a vet to be present at independent tracks?
Yeah. That's part of the consideration that we're looking at in terms of what a licence would look like for an unregulated track here in Scotland. I think we heard from Paul Brignall that their vet was literally 5 minutes down the road and they had a relationship with him. I'm not sure that's entirely satisfactory in terms of what the requirements should be, but it would certainly be part of what we would consider if we go down the route of requiring that track to have a licence.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Rhoda Grant.
Can I ask about banned substances? And some organisations have suggested that there should be an independent regulatory body to look for banned substances.
How would we do that? Yeah. Was the comment that you got, was that in relation to the GBGB tracks?
Well, there's no drug testing at Thornton's either, so we don't know if there is any substance misuse there.
Is there something that we did about that? Yeah. Again, when we start looking at the potential for a licence, and that would be something we'd have to consider in that remit.
Okay, so you've given it no thought?
No, at this moment, no.
Again, Minister, this has been something that's been on the table for quite some time now. And we've had the SAWC report, we've had evidence sessions, and at the moment you're not prepared to say whether there's a need for an independent body to regulate the use of banned substances.
The government hasn't looked in detail at the banned substance side of this. No, we haven't.
So you don't have a position on that?
No, we don't at this moment, no.
Okay, thank you. Can I ask you, do you agree with the Scottish Animal Welfare Commission that whilst kennels might provide adequate care, they do not appear compatible with giving dogs a good quality of life?
No, I don't. I don't agree with that position. I've had working dogs my entire life. My dogs have all lived in kennels, and they have been more than happy to live in kennels. Some farmers have their dogs in the house. It wasn't something I chose to do. But I had no animal welfare concerns about any of my dogs or the conditions of any of my shepherd friends or farming friends. So that's not a position that I would share.
Okay, thank you. Alistair Allen.
Thank you, Convener. I'm conscious that there are people in the room who know more about this issue than I do, but I just wanted to ask a bit about the rehoming of dogs. And essentially to ask, is it your feeling on the basis of the evidence that you've had that racing is creating a problem which is kind of being left to society to solve, i.e. the rehoming of dogs?
I would agree with that assertion, yeah.
So is that a sustainable thing going forward? I mean, should we allow that to... Let me rephrase that. Are the costs and the welfare issues around the rehome, or rather the need to rehome, something that's acceptable? Should we allow that to be there?
Yeah, well, my understanding is that GBGB are actually doing something work around that themselves, because they've identified that as a problem as well. In terms of what we do as in Scotland, I'm not sure that it's the same issue again here in Scotland than what it is elsewhere. However, you're possibly right in what you're saying, but is that it shouldn't be a societal issue to clean up if the sport is creating a problem.
And we've heard from them, there will be people in Scotland who race dogs at commercial English tracks.
Yep.
So they are part of this, presumably, commercial, or this process of commercial racing, which will result in dogs which may need to be rehoused, and not all of which dogs will be socialised enough to be rehoused. So are these people not creating... It's a provocative question, I'm just looking for your view. But are these people not creating a problem which is then left to others to sort out?
Yes, potentially that. And if they're racing at GBGB tracks down south, if that's the point that you're making, GBGB are actually looking at what they would do with that. But I actually take the point that you're making, that if they're breeding dogs that then need to be rehomed and they've been kennelled and they haven't been suitably socialised, then I take that as a point, yes.
Thank you, Camilla.
Yeah, on the back of that, once again, the SAWC suggests that if there wasn't any racing in Scotland, as we've heard, it's still possible to own, breed, kennel and train greyhounds in the country. And they suggested that a scheme independent of GBGB is required to ensure the welfare of these animals, possibly through local authority regulation or under the auspices of the new Scotland Veterinary Service. What's your views on a scheme of that type?
you answer that one. Sorry, I'm going to let Andrew answer that question, OK?
Yeah, I mean, I think this probably gets into the area of licensing proposals. And as you know, we consulted recently on licensing different activities, including sort of boarding and equine establishments. So this probably falls into the same area. This potentially in the future we could consider whether there is a need to control people who are keeping dogs for sporting purposes. Our understanding, at least, is that there are relatively few of these people. As you said, you have heard evidence from people who keep dogs in Scotland and race in the north of England. I suppose it's a matter of proportionality that we have lots of other premises and other initiatives that we want to take forwards. But if we're thinking about that potentially controlling those, then it is something potentially we could control in the future through licensing schemes.
Okay, but back again to the Minister. It's quite some time since the Animal Welfare Commission published that report. Are you suggesting you have done nothing to look at potentially introducing a scheme like that? You've not considered it at all, or have you done any work?
We haven't considered it at this stage. We're looking at it as potentially as part of the whole licensing.
Okay. Eleanor Whittam.
Thanks, Convener. You kind of picked up on some of the parts of the question I was going to ask round about whether the 2021 statutory animal licensing framework would perhaps be extended to include looking at greyhound racing and how you know that there could be a licensing approach to that that would maybe address some of the concerns that we have. And I just guess I've got a question round about, you know, with my former local authority hat on here, thinking about the implications for local government if that was to be extended. And I guess it would be a plea to you know, to ask the government whether that's something that they would be actively looking at, whether any such regulations coming forward would have, you know, consideration of COSLA involved and licensing officers taking their concerns into account. But is it indeed one of the only ways where we could perhaps look to regulate this area more, considering we do have the crossover impact of people in Scotland having dogs that are racing in England as well? So
in terms of involving COSLA or involving the local authority with that licence, is that what you're asking me? Yes.
Yeah, I'm looking to, you know, to further on from what the convener was asking, you know, whether the government is considering extending the licensing requirements to include greyhound racing. We know that people were very split evenly down the middle in terms of what that consultation told us. But is it a way to start to try and address some of the issues if indeed the members' bill that's going through doesn't reach its conclusion?
Yeah, we've said, the licensing is definitely something that we're looking at, and it would clearly require a local authority to be part of that process and that consideration as we, if we take that forward, yes.
Thank you.
Okay. Do I have a supplement from Emma Roddick? Thank
you.
Yeah,
just on the licensing being considered, could the Minister say a bit more about what the aims of that regulation would be?
It would be to alleviate some of the concerns that people have around the fact that the track is currently unlicensed. So we've heard evidence from Paul Brignall to say SSPCA have never been called. The argument I would have presumed from Mark, and we've had this conversation, is that, well, why would somebody phone the SSPCA when they're part of that system? So therefore, somebody going independently that's not there for the racing may well be something that would help to alleviate some of the concerns about what happens at a dog track.
So am I understanding correctly that the consideration is for the track in Scotland, not for wider ownership or racing of dogs for those who are resident in Scotland?
We could actually look at that, but at the moment we're talking about the track in Scotland.
Okay, and just finally, I understand that there are very few such trainers in Scotland. I think 27 is the number that the committee is working with. That's quite a small number of people to have a licensing scheme for. I imagine that would be expensive to administer. Is that being considered tacked on to other licensing schemes?
All of those things will be considered when we get down to the detail what that might look like.
Okay.
What are the timescales?
The timescales that we're looking right now at what we're going to do in terms of whether we license the track or not.
Okay. Mark Ruskell.
Yeah, I'm interested about whether licensing would actually reduce the number
of serious injuries and deaths. I'm talking, Minister, about serious injuries. You know, I've got a greyhound myself. He goes out for runs, you know, occasionally in a field or whatever, and he might get a cut here and there. But the kind of injuries that he had when he was racing were far more significant, you know, broken hock. And we see this with greyhounds coming the whole time. So I'm just wondering, in terms of preventing those, you know, catastrophic injuries and in some cases dogs being put down, what would licensing actually do to prevent that? Because I can see maybe having a vet on site to sort of help clear up after an accident or whatever, you know, and treat a dog might be useful, but I'm struggling to see how licensing would fundamentally change the picture that we've got, which is that when dogs are racing around a track at 40 mile an hour, they do break their legs, they do collide into each other, they do suffer, you know, from amputations and a whole range of injuries. So what would actually bring down through licensing that catastrophic injury?
What it would bring is a level of external scrutiny and then data, which could then potentially go to the what you're looking for, which is a ban, if the proportionality of those injuries was such that this is inherently going to cause a problem ongoing, so therefore you might use that licensing scheme. If you took a license away from somebody, they can no longer race, that is effectively a ban. So it's the license would be an additional measure of making sure that every welfare requirement was put in place to make this as safe a sport for the people who are doing it as possible and for the dogs. So the license would just give us a little bit more oversight to then be able to see that it was being done properly.
So it would be a way of kind of monitoring and yes, getting data on deaths and injuries.
Yes.
But we've already got data on deaths and injuries. I mean, across UK there was 22,284 dogs with, you know, significant injuries between 2018 and 2022, and I think 868 dogs that had died. And that included Shawfield in Glasgow, where, as I said earlier, you know, the injury rate was actually slightly higher than the GB average. So I'm just wondering how much more kind of data do you need? I mean, it could be the fact that if Thornton doesn't continue to race, you'll never get the data. But there is a lot of data that we already have from dogs racing around tracks at 40 mile an hour. And I'm just wondering how many times do we need dogs to be racing around a track at 40 mile an hour to recognise that they break their legs, they have catastrophic injuries, they get put down?
I go back to the point that I am making a differentiation between the kind of racing that's happening at Thornton to the kind of racing that's happening in GBGB, highly professional tracks. So if we bring a licensing scheme in, that will allow us to monitor exactly what's happening in Thornton, and if it's required at a later date that we make a decision to take that license away because of welfare issues, then we could do that. But it would have to be proportionate to what we've talked about already in terms of the welfare and the social aspects of what this does for the people who actually go and do it. So it's the proportionality of it, but it allows us to have a better oversight of what's actually happening.
But if you're licensing an activity and you know pretty well what the levels of injuries and deaths would be from that, are you not just licensing animal cruelty? You're just saying, we're going to continue doing this because it's worth monitoring.
No, we're not, because we don't know what's happening at Thornton is in the same scale as what you're talking about in other GBGB tracks. And I think it would be unfair to the people who do that unless we actually go through the process and there is a specific reason to say that license is no longer valid because of these reasons, that would be what would stop it. Okay. But I come back to the point about inherent risk. There's risk in everything. You can't take away risk. You know, I could walk out in front of a bus and I'll get killed because I've taken a risk of crossing the road. And these dogs love running. They're pursuit dogs. They absolutely love what they're doing. It's the same as any working sheepdog. It's the same as any working Labrador. There is inherent risk in everything that they do, the same as we have risk. And this trying to take away all risk, for me, is part of the issue. As long as these dogs are being properly cared for, well looked after, they're nurtured, they're enjoying what they're doing, then it's like footballers go out and play football every week. They could risk breaking their leg and get finished. So it's an inherent risk in everything that all of us take part in. Mm.
But there are limits, right? So, I mean, we no longer send children up chimneys to clean chimneys because there's an inherent risk with that.
No, we didn't send. We stopped sending children up chimneys to sweep chimneys because it was ultimately.
You wouldn't introduce a licensing scheme for that, would you? So, why would you introduce a licensing scheme something where you know there's inherent risk?
Would you like us to consider a licensing scheme for putting children up chimneys? I don't see the analogy, and I'm not biting on it.
But from what you've already said, Minister, that you think there's a balance between the social benefit and the animal welfare risks. Currently, you don't think there's need for a licence because there's no issue there.
Well, we're looking at the potential for a licence, and we're continuing to look at that. I would like to go to the track and go and have a look for myself and see what is happening at the track. I just don't want the government to ban something that is part of the social fabric of that community on the basis of stuff that we haven't fully explored. So I'd like to explore it further.
Emma Harper.
Another question related to the licensing, if that was the way to go forward. The GBGB have anti-doping guidance, and they've created percentages of how many dogs would be tested for amphetamines, cocaine, other drugs that are banned substances. So would a licensing scheme have some kind of guidance to require vets being on premises? We want X number of dogs to be tested for banned substances, for instance.
Again, that would come part of, be part of any licensing scheme that a vet would be on site to be on. And I'm not technical on this one, so I'm going to ask Andrew to confirm whether or not you can actually do that on the track.
Yeah, I think the advantages of having a vet on the site, and SAWC outlined this in their report as well, so it would be to inspect the dogs before racing and potentially take samples or be aware that there may be suspicions of doping in them, potentially take random samples with the agreement of the track owner, as well as being there to deal with any immediate injuries and give first aid, and also look at the dogs after they've raced as well. So a vet could potentially require samples to be taken, or if they had suspicions of doping, they could take further action. But these are the sort of details that we could develop in a future licensing scheme if we decide to go down that route.
Okay, thanks.
I've got a further supplementary, then I'm moving to Alistair Allen. Jamie Hulker-Johnson.
Sorry, it's just a very quick one, Convener, and based on what you had asked previously as well. I mean, we've heard some anecdotal evidence. There's obviously been, from yourself, some evidence raised by other kind of colleagues and the like, and you've said, in terms of your proposals going forward, you're looking into it, you're considering, etc. You've not said when, and I'm not looking for kind of due course. When do you think you'll be in a position to put forward your proposals?
I can't give you an exact timescale at the moment. All I can tell you is that we're looking at it right now.
3 months, 6 months, within a year?
I'm not going to give you a time, because unfortunately there's an awful lot of work going on at the moment. So we are in the process of looking at that, amongst other things.
Okay.
Alistair Allen.
Thank you, Convener. It was just really a quick question just to ask again about licensing. But I mean, the focus of our conversation there has been very much about the potential licensing of tracks. But is the licensing potentially of kennels in your mind, and if so, what would that mean?
No, it hadn't been, but it's something I'll take away.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, Rhoda Grant.
The Scottish Animal Welfare Commission, one of their recommendations was that no further greyhound tracks are permitted in Scotland. What is your response to that?
If we get a potential opening of another track, then we would have to consider that. But right now, we don't have that situation in front of us.
And what tools do you have to consider that? We don't have licensing at the moment. Is there things like planning permission? How could you influence whether or not it opened at the minute?
Do we have regulations that we can... We can't influence planning, but we can certainly do something on licensing.
Okay.
So, yeah, sorry, go on, Rhoda.
So at the moment you can do something on licensing, in what regard if greyhound tracks?
We're in the process of working on looking at how we would bring a licence into play if that's what we decide to do. So that would come under the same regime. If any other track was looking to open in Scotland, they would have to come under a licensing scheme as well.
Okay, but if someone decided tomorrow, I'm opening a greyhound track, there is no licensing scheme, so they'll be able to do that if the local authority give them planning permission.
Yeah, if the local authority give them planning permission, yes, at this moment in time.
Okay, thank you.
So currently the government have no powers at all to start or to prevent Shawfield opening or any additional greyhound racing tracks?
As far as I understand at this moment in time, no.
Okay. I've got Emma and then Mark.
Just very briefly, can I clarify whether the Minister is comfortable with that being the position, that at the moment a new track could open, we don't know what kind of conditions the dogs racing within it would be under. Is that a position that he's confident and comfortable in?
Given the decline of racing in Scotland at the moment, I'm comfortable it's unlikely to happen. But if there was a situation where it was on the rise and it was starting to come back in, then I would be much more concerned to make sure we were taking action.
Is it not harder then for the Scottish Government to try to prevent something when it's already begun? Kind of going back to the Minister's comments around something already being part of the fabric of the community or preventing someone from carrying on something that they currently have a right to do, would it not be easier to just say no more tracks in Scotland above what is currently in operation?
It would certainly be easier, but right now, as I said, we're looking at the potential for a licensing scheme, so that's the position that we're going to continue to work on.
Okay.
Mark Ruskell.
Yeah, I think you said at the outset, Minister, that you're not persuaded by the argument that the petitioners have brought forward and this committee has been looking at for some time now, and you don't feel right.
I'd say we're neutral.
Okay, you're not. Well, you did say you weren't persuaded at this point. You didn't feel that it was proportionate. That was your kind of starting point on it. I'm just wondering where public opinion sits within this, because we've spoke a lot this morning about, you know, a very small number of people who, you know, own and race dogs at Thornton. But, you know, public opinion is pretty strongly behind a ban on greyhound racing, which is what the petitioners want. The petition itself was the most signed petition in the 25-year history of this place. So I'm interested in where you think public opinion sits. And as I go back to the legislation that was passed in the last session of Parliament, which prohibited wild animals, the performance display and exhibition of wild animals in travelling circuses. At that time, and I think Mr. Voss will know more about this, given that he worked on that bill, there weren't any wild animals in travelling circuses in Scotland. Well, there were very, very few. There weren't many animals that were, you know, involved in that. So arguably, it perhaps wasn't the biggest animal welfare issue in Scotland at that time, but there was a strong public support for a ban on the use of wild animals in travelling circuses. And to give the government its due, it moved forward on that legislation. It was considered by the committee and it was passed. So I'm just wondering what you think then about public opinion. Does that have any bearing with this government?
Of course, public opinion has a bearing on it, and one of the things that we took out of the consultation was the fact that a lot of people wanted a licence, which is why we're looking specifically at a licence scheme. And I get that there are people that want it banned, but we must try and find the proportionality and the balance. And of course, public opinion is vitally important in us considering how we go forward on that.
Okay. Thank you. Minister, I think that concludes our question. I think certainly what I would welcome would be your commitment to come back to this committee when you can actually answer some of the questions that we've had, because we've not, in my opinion, gained very much information on what the government's position is, and I understand that you're looking at the licensing. So can you commit to come back to this committee when you have indeed come to a conclusion on the future of greyhound racing in Scotland?
Yes, I can.
Thank you. And that concludes our business in public. I now suspend the meeting for a short comfort break and we'll move into private session.